and welcome to my easy to understand guide to sound. Sound is something that some people find very easy to analyse or discuss if they're literally talking about the things coming out of someone's mouth, but very hard to discuss for some reason if it's things like sound effects, soundtracks, sound bridges, narration, voiceover, etc. So I've tried to put together in this video a common list with examples of common sound techniques you will find in moving image products, and I've tried to explain why they might be used, what they connote, what impact they might have on an audience, and hopefully that helps you with analysing products for your media studies exams.
So diegetic sound is any sound which originates inside the world of the character. So for example, if you were a character in that scene, you could hear that sound. It's the most common sound that you find, and that can include things like dialogue and what people can hear. It can be things like the footsteps, and if somebody turns a radio on, any sound which is created inside that world of the scene. It helps us to understand what the character can hear, so it helps to immerse us into the scene, and it adds a sense of realism because we can hear what the character can hear. So non-diegetic sound is any sound which originates outside of the scene and the characters cannot hear. So for example, if you add on things like a soundtrack, or if there's like a voiceover that has been added on over the top, and we'll come to those as separate key terms, but non-diegetic sound is this anything that which people cannot hear if they were inside the scene. It adds a certain level of ambience and tone, and it sometimes adds extra information. So if there's a piece of sound like a voiceover, for example, that's been added on, it helps us to understand a bit more. There must be a reason why they've chosen to add that non-diegetic sound on. Dialogue is literally the words the characters say.
It's the question that brought you here. You know the question, just as I did.
What is the Matrix?
The answer is out there, Neo. It's looking for you.
They tell us a lot of information, obviously. It tells us what that character is like. It tells us, what kind of person they are, how they behave. They might literally tell us information. For example, in an advert, they might give the audience information that helps us to understand a product more. And in a media product where there's two characters perhaps talking together, it shows the relationship between those characters, the way they talk to each other, what they say, how they talk to another person, helps to communicate something about them. Asynchronous sound, a complex term, sound that is not synced up to the visuals, or it can be sound that's from a totally unrelated scene. So I'm going to try and show you some examples of this. If somebody is talking on the screen and their voice is not synced up, you will notice it is out of sync normally.
So you'll notice that my voice is out of sync, and that can be very distracting.
It's normally an error. It makes it seem quite amateur, and it does take away some realism from the scene because you realise that somebody's messed it up. Or it could be sound that is asynchronous because it's from another scene that is not the one you're seeing on the screen at the time. So, for example, in this particular example, you start off seeing a scene of a christening that is going on the screen. This is from the film Godfather. But then what we do is we change to another scene, or a series of scenes actually, where people are being killed. But the sound from the christening is still being heard across the scene that is on the screen. So we can't see the christening, but that christening sound is over the top of these killing scenes. And it adds to a theme. There's a meaning. There's a reason. It's not an error. The editor didn't do it by mistake. Sound mixer didn't leave it on there by mistake. It's to highlight something. And in this particular example, I guess the christening, the noise and the sound of the christening and the religion and the kind of traditions of religion are highlighting the contrast between what the audience is hearing and seeing. A baby being born, life coming into the world, and religion and the talk about protecting life is a contrast thematically with the sounds of people being murdered. So sometimes asynchronous sound can help to add to that meaning. Contrapuntal sound is very similar to asynchronous sound. It is when the non-diegetic sound on a shot, so the music in particular, does not seem to have the same atmospheric tone as the visuals. So for example, you might have light-hearted music on top of the scene of a massacre. There's a scene where a character in Reservoir Dogs is torturing another character, and he even cuts his ear off. But the music that is on the top is a quite a light-hearted, fun song on the radio. And it's very weird because you're hearing this quite light-hearted tune with the visuals of somebody being tortured. And again, that kind of highlights the atmosphere of the visuals. It makes it almost more torturous. It makes it more graphic and almost more scary. And it adds maybe a hidden meaning to the scene. So for example, in the Reservoir Dogs scene, it highlights the fact that the character doing the torturing is perhaps a little bit crazy. Maybe he's enjoying this torture a bit too much, the fact that he seems to be listening to this quite light-hearted music. There's a very famous opening scene to the horror film The Shining, where a family are driving to a beautiful hotel in amazing landscape, kind of mountains and beautiful scenery. But the music you're getting on top of the scene is really quite scary and dramatic and ominous. This contrapuntal sound, it helps to add some meaning. It makes the situation seem odd. We know something bad is going to happen because we are seeing this beautiful scenery and a lovely family in a car, but with quite terrifying music. So the contrapuntal nature of the sound highlights the fact and perhaps foreshadows the fact that something bad is going to happen later on. Sound effects are sounds that often don't get picked up by cameras. You will notice this if you've ever filmed with your mobile phone. It doesn't pick up sound that's particularly far away. But a Foley artist, their job is to add those sound effects back in. So, for example, footsteps on floors or squeaking doors or a kettle boiling or a doorbell, for example. And those sound effects are often quite good for adding realism to a scene. It makes it seem quite natural if we can hear all those sounds. It makes us feel as though we are in the scene. And sometimes, depending on the sound effect, it can add tension. A sound motif is a sound that seems to reoccur regularly, particularly to indicate the presence of a particular character or setting or situation. In the film franchise Jaws, they had a very particular sound in the music, in the non-diegetic soundtrack, that highlighted when the shark was near. And that was quite good for foreshadowing to us as an audience that the shark was going to come onto the screen. It helped to make us feel scared before anything scary had even happened. And it build up the tension for people watching. So depending on the sound, it might add a particular theme or atmosphere to the piece. A sound bridge is a particular sound which continues across the cutting of two scenes. So if you go from one scene to another scene, that's cross-cutting, but the sound from one of those scenes continues into the next one.
Now, what happened after the lineup?
The desk sergeant was actually trying to tell me that he couldn't release...
It links those two scenes or two shots together, and that might connote a link between two places or two people or two situations.
And I looked in the phone book and there's a... yourself storage facility right outside of downtown Baltimore, sir.
A voiceover is when somebody is talking or narrating over the top of a shot. So you are currently listening to my voiceover as I talk over the top of this PowerPoint. You can't see me talking, but you can just hear me. It's good for giving the audience extra information about something or somebody. They will often use voiceovers in things like adverts to give you more information about a product. So voiceovers are quite good for giving you extra info. Mode of address. That is the way a character talks. So not what they say, but how they say it. And that is things like how formal their words are. Are they using slang or colloquialisms? Are they using a particular language? Are they talking angrily or softly or sadly, or whatever a choice it might be? It gives the audience another real clue about that character. It tells us about how they feel and what kind of person they are. Some types of mode of address, those modes of address might engage specific audiences. So for example, if you want to engage a really young target audience, you might use really simple, casual, informal language. If you want to engage a more educated audience or an older audience, you might use much more complex language, more jargon, and it sets the tone of the piece you're looking at as well. If you want something to seem very serious, you might use a very serious, formal mode of address. Direct address is when a character talks directly to the audience, often by looking straight at the camera. It's quite good at engaging the audience, so it does make you feel part of the scene. It makes us feel like we are friends with the character, or they are our friend. So it's quite good at drawing in an audience.
It's on European socialism. I mean, really, what's the point? I'm not European. I don't plan on being European. So who gives a crap if they're socialists? They can be fascist anarchists. It still wouldn't change the fact that I don't own a car.
But it does make something seem quite comic and informal. You don't see it in TV or film a lot unless it's a comedy. It's much more common in music videos and adverts for obvious reasons. They often sing straight to the camera, and in adverts they often talk straight to the audience about a product. But it definitely takes away the realism of the piece. If somebody talks straight to the camera, it makes us realise there's a camera there. And so it does take away a bit of the realism, but it is good for that drawing in an audience. The score, or the soundtrack, sometimes as it's known, is the non-diegetic music that is typically added over the top of a media product. People will choose different music for different things. So setting the scene and adding a particular ambiance or tone to a piece. If you want something to seem very lighthearted and funny, you might use much, you know, very lighthearted comic music, for example. And depending on the music, it can encourage the audience to feel a certain way about a scene or a character. If you want to add this feeling of kind of ominous tension, the sound mixer might choose a soundtrack which is particularly ominous in style. Ambient sound is the sound which naturally occurs in a particular location. So, for example, if we were stood in the middle of London at Piccadilly Circus, the ambient sound would be traffic and people shouting and taxis and footsteps and chatting. If we were stood in a forest, it would be the birds tweeting and the, I don't know, maybe crickets and other like kind of forest noises and trees rustling. So it's natural sound that would occur in that location. It doesn't mean that the sound wasn't added on by a sound mixer. It could be done through, you know, a Foley artist. It doesn't have to have been picked up on the camera itself, but it's the scene which creates this feeling of natural sound in the location. And it adds a sense of realism. It's obviously diegetic sound. It sets the scene for the audience and it makes us feel like we are there. If we're hearing all the sounds that the characters would hear if they were there, it helps us to put ourselves in the scene too. It's also worth, when looking at sound, to make sure you don't forget about silence or the lack of sound. Any pauses or gaps or any moments where the sound goes totally quiet is just as important as the moments where there is a lot of sound. Pauses and gaps in diegetic and non-diegetic sound are good for drawing the audience's attention to something. Sometimes it shows that someone has nothing to say. Does not want to say anything. That might tell us something about a character. If they don't talk or they don't respond or they keep quiet, it might tell us something about them. And it can add tension as well, because you're often waiting for someone to fill silence. You want someone to say something or for the sound to kick in. And if it doesn't, it can build up the tension. Thank you. And last but not least, you also want to consider volume of sound, not just absence of sound, but volume and the quality as well. So if something is very quiet or has been deliberately muffled, it might help us to see the sound from a particular character's perspective. It's a very famous scene in Saving Private Ryan, where the Tom Hanks character is hearing very muffled sounds, and it helps us to hear the scene from his perspective. It's as though his hearing has been damaged by all the explosions and the gunshots, but it also helps us to see how shocked he is and how detached he is from what is going on around him. Or sometimes the sound is deliberately made louder, and that is to add drama and excitement as well. So the volume of what is going on, it might be important to consider as well.
So that was my easy to understand guide to sound. If you've got any questions, please drop them below. Otherwise, don't forget to hit subscribe for more videos that are useful for both GCSE and A-level media studies.